people that don't believe it. I think I saw the other day, I got an email from Box Park, which is this weird little, you know, sort of like retail bar, restaurant sort of unit things that are made in little crates that they put around. I think they got one in Brixton, they got one in Shoreditch. They probably have some or located all around the world. They're a cool little, they're a great way to do like a pop-up shop, shopping mall without, you know, having the infrastructure that you need to kind of build one without having to build, you know, putting, you know, concrete bricks up or glass buildings or whatever. Maybe you can essentially put a couple of crates together in a clever way, obviously well insulated, done really well, up to spec, blah blah blah. And then you could also create like a little, you know, a little hipster shopping mall hangout people can go to after work and get drunk, get fed and have a dance. So that was I got an email from their CEO. I think it's like a marketing information email, just to kind of make ever sure everyone's abreast of the situation, which essentially kind of said, hey, the government hasn't told us to close down, so we're not going to close down. We're going to open for business on the weekend, which, you know, is their prerogative. I think a lot of businesses are in that position now where if the they're kind of following what the government mandate is. But I think we're in a place now where if you read enough accounts, especially an account I read from a journalist from Italy. Let's see if I can get up on my Twitter, actually. It was a pretty cool op-ed that he read, I think, in the Boston Herald or one of those kind of newspapers, right? And he essentially said that, I think he's Italian too, and he basically said that we should take heed or lessons from the Italian epidemic or the Italian pandemic and kind of make the adjustments that we need to make now instead of waiting later on, because those adjustments are going to prevent a lot of unnecessary deaths. But it seems as if a lot of nations, the UK included, are waiting for it to get really bad before they make the necessary adjustments, which is understandable too, because I think there is this assumption that if you make a move now and tell people to kind of stay indoors, you know, not to go anywhere, lockdown, to be very vigilant, it's going to make people hysterical and they're going to go out there and start, you know, queuing outside of shops ahead of time, you know, especially before the time of lockdown, and people are just going to go overboard and go crazy. So maybe doing it in a gradual, slow way is the right way to go about things, to avoid a riot on the streets and shit, especially if the hospitals are lacking beds and lacking adequate nurses. And I'm sure the police forces don't have enough people to kind of man the streets and make sure people are not getting stabbed over, you know, over a baguette somewhere. So I definitely get that. But this article, hopefully I'll find it here, definitely spoke about it a lot more succinctly than I am going to do it now. And I'm going to quickly read it to you. It's from the Boston Globe, right? And it kind of outlines a lot of the issues that are kind of happening now with the coronavirus kind of spreading and people just not taking it seriously. And I would kind of level that kind of sentiment towards the UK and the US. It seems that the UK and the US isn't just, you know, we're just not in a place to kind of deal with this stuff in a sensible, rational way until it gets to a really, really bad place, which is unfortunate to see, really. So let's just make sure I've got this all loaded, open it up a little bit. Hopefully you can see that on the screen. So this is an article from the Boston Globe. It's called A Coronavirus Cautionary Tale from Italy. Don't do what we did, right? And it's from a guy called Mattia Ferrarisi. I'm going to link in the show notes for you guys to read yourselves, but I'm going to quickly go through it and it's going to kind of lay the groundwork for my kind of overall thoughts on the situation. So he says the following. There was a headline in March 11 in the whatever Italian newspaper that is, a leading newspaper in Italy, that informed us that hospitals in Italy's north, the epicenter of the coronavirus outbreak in our country, were being stretched thin and the healthcare system was on the brink of collapse. An anesthesiologist at the hospital of Bergamo, one of the cities with the most cases of COVID-19, the illness caused by the new coronavirus, told the paper that the intensive care units were already at capacity and doctors were being forced to start making difficult decisions, admitting people who desperately need medical mechanical ventilation based on age, life expectancy and other factors. Just like in wartime, the article was impeccably placed on page 15. While the main headline on the newspaper front page relayed the political quarrels over the measurements to the curb the contagion. So as per usual, there is a sentiment at the moment that instead of actually dealing with the issue, putting in some preventive measures, there's a lot of infighting, a lot of finger pointing, a lot of finger wagging, and just a lot of blaming in general, right? Which is definitely not, there is a time and a place for that, I'm pretty sure, especially if you want to gain an advantage on your political rivals. But now, especially with the looming danger of this getting worse before it gets better, it's just not the time for it, is it? But anyway, the article continues here. It says, the hospital in Bergamo, was not only the hospital in the area dealing with the lack of capacity and rationing of care. The same day, I heard from a manager in Lombardy healthcare system, among the most advanced and well-funded in Europe, that he saw anesthesiologists weeping in hospital hallways because of the choices they were having to make. In the days since, over 100 hospitals have set up tents as makeshift hospital wards, and cargo containers have been placed at the entrances of medical centers to sort out patients coming at an increasing pace. Some of the people who can't get medical care are dying in their homes, which is one of the most sad things to hear, because I think for the most, especially in it's different regions, different countries have different things. I always get the impression that, especially in the UK, we don't really give a shit about our older people, our older population. I remember there was a time when I was younger. Well, when I was younger, my aunt used to live in a place next to, are they called allotments, or I forgot what they're called? Bungalow? Is it a bungalow? I think it's a bungalow, right? Yeah, allotments or garden. I think my aunt used to live in an area that was surrounded by bungalows, right? So predominantly bungalows are like these one-level homes that are really sparse and really big and really easy accessible, and they're usually built with elderly people in mind, right? So they can navigate and be independent and get around their house without having to navigate upstairs and shit. So it's pretty well done and they're pretty well laid out. So there's a lot of those places in the UK, especially in London. But I guess over time, due to gentrification, all that stuff, and maybe with the population aging out in some respects, those houses have now been getting demolished and they've been getting turned into like little, you know, epicenters of cool, you know, shiny metal and glass structures for people to sit in and drink, you know, £10 coffees in. And essentially, and then I also, I'm not too sure, I haven't done the research, but I'm pretty sure the funding for like old people's homes or care homes essentially has gone down. So a lot of those places where you could send older people who probably couldn't live in bungalows on their own are, you know, few and far between. And if there are those are available, they're probably, you know, way out of people's price ranges. So generally there's like a lack of kind of empathy or care given to older people or older population. But you get the feeling like Italy, Spain, maybe places in France have a different relationship with their older population, right? There's a lot more respect, there's a lot more honor, there's a lot more reverence given to an older generation, because, you know, they've been there, done that, wore the t-shirt. So people, regardless if they're your own relatives or not, have a lot of respect for them in general. So they try and, you know, and they sometimes, especially in, I'd imagine, in kind of, you know, Mediterranean communities, you know, older people are revered in the family, right? They're probably sometimes the only living relatives that you might have, right? They maybe have outlasted your parents, or maybe they're the only people kind of holding it down in your own city because your parents moved away to, you know, seek fame and fortune and they were still there. Or maybe, you know, your parents split up and you have to live with your aunt, your granddad or grandma. So there's a lot of kind of respect given to them, right? People still live with their grandparents sometimes in those kind of countries, in, you know, in their 30s and shit. So I guess for an Italian community to have, you know, people that they know and love, older people dying of a virus that they didn't know existed a few weeks ago, it must be really distressing. And again, I think that's what's caused them to react. Whereas I think in the UK, because they don't really have to have that relationship with our older population, I think it's going to take, you know, somebody prominent, maybe somebody that we know in pop culture to die, unfortunately, for us to kind of really gain an understanding of what's actually going on. Because you're seeing it anyway happening in general, right? You're seeing how people are reacting positively or reacting in a more productive or proactive way when they heard the football was getting cancelled. So imagine if, you know, I'm not going to say a name, but imagine if a name, X name of a celebrity who happens to be under the age of what you expect people to die from coronavirus ends up getting passes away. That's when people wake up to it. But you don't want that, really. You want preventive measures now. But anyway, let's continue the article. So, in the days since, as more medical professionals started to describe their similar situations on social media and interviews, the Italian Society of Anesthesiologists published extraordinary new guidelines to help doctors facing an ethical dilemmas, making clear that the first come first serve criterion that had been used amongst patients with same illnesses and level of risk in ordinary times was not appropriate in dealing with the current emergency. Right, so until last week, the Italian public healthcare system had a capacity to care for everyone. Our country has a universal healthcare, so patients aren't turned away from hospitals here. But in a matter of days, the system has been failed by a virus that I and many other Italians had failed to take seriously. And that is really sad, because I remember someone saying the same thing, that the reason why this is going to get worse is because there isn't preventative measures in place to make sure that we don't have a surge of people going to hospital at the same time. What you want to do is that you want to have people contained in some regard, or take better care and not do unnecessary travel, all that stuff, so that the virus doesn't spread as aggressively as it should do, or if you're kind of just, you know, going by your everyday life, so that the hospitals could then have a kind of like a staggered period of kind of receiving people in, making sure they're treated, sending them home, and then taking the new people in. But if everyone's getting sick at the same time at high amounts and catching the virus all at one time, and they're all flooding the hospitals, they're not going to be enough beds for everyone. So it's a really sad indictment if you get to a point where you're kind of building overflow tents. It means you didn't prepare prior. So it continues. The inability of the medical system to deal with the flow of patients in critical condition is not one of the problems of this complex medical is one is not one of the problems of problems of medical no sorry the inability of the medical system to deal with the flow of patients in critical condition is not one of the problems of this complex medical emergency. It is the problem. I shouldn't have to be surprised. As a journalist, I have read, heard, and spoken to several experts explaining the most immediate threat to COVID-19 was hospital systems becoming overwhelmed, as I mentioned, and therefore the most pressing need was to avoid too many people getting sick at the same time, as resources are limited. It's what's called flattening the curve. But that information was somehow stored in some remote interstice of my mind, covered in an incessant flow of bits and charts on the morality rate of the elderly, political mismanagement, and quarrels over under-testing and over-testing, market collapses, projections of the economic impacts of the epidemic, and so on. All of this, of course, extremely relevant, but at the same time feels totally irrelevant when lives are being lost in a situation that was preventable. As of Friday night, 1,266 people have died in Italy due to the outbreak. And again, this can all be avoided if we did the preventive measures. So again, I really recommend you check it out. It's a really long article. I won't read the whole thing, but it's very, very informative.